go ahead. Yeah, we'll be ready in about 30 seconds.
09er, San Echo, from center 134.37.
And Oakland, F-846 is ready to split off. I can either go straight ahead and climb or stay at 36.
Hello, Air 156, Center Coven Center 121.25.
Startup script, red bar achieved. Go ahead and turn on the hydraulic pump to low.
Pressure on low.
Ready to run the spectrum?
We're ready.
54,000 pound up low.
Starting.
Pacing on left 4. 4,500.
Needles are up, releasing now.
On condition.
Christchurch is certainly a big part of the answer, both because you have really good weather here this time of year and you have some really nice objects in the sky.
I'm personally excited about having Dream Chaser here at Dryden. I can't think of a better place to be testing a vehicle like this than bringing it right out here to the Edwards Dry Lake bed, which is very historic in its own right.
3, 2, 1, release, release, release.
I have enormous affection for this place, its people, and its vision for the future of the world of flight. And I believe that whenever I have the privilege of visiting here again and years ahead and ask someone, what's new? There'll always be something.
Good afternoon. I'm Cam Martin, NASA Armstrong Flight Research Center's head of the Office of External Affairs, and it's my pleasure to welcome you on behalf of our Center Director, David McBride. This week, we're celebrating the 50th anniversary of the first flight of the Lunar Landing Research Vehicle. At this time, I'd like to recognize our guests from the original LLRV team, who will be coming on stage a little later for a panel discussion. But I'd like you to welcome Don Malik, the LLRV pilot. Gene Matranga, the LLRV project manager. Wayne Ottinger, the LLRV project engineer. And Dave Stoddard, the rocket shop supervisor. I'd also like to thank John Kelly from the Center's Exploration and Space Technology Mission Directorate and Wayne Ottinger, because without their enthusiasm, insight, and behind-the-scenes support helping pull this event together, we wouldn't be sitting here right now celebrating this. This past July, we celebrated the 45th anniversary of the Apollo 11 mission. The Apollo program was designed to land humans on the moon and bring them back safely to Earth. Getting to the moon was an enormous undertaking. Landing on the moon was a challenge all its own. Had to land an aerospace vehicle before you ever took off in it. You had to do it for the first time it had ever flown. The pilot was going to have to land on an unimproved field that no human had ever visited, and with no navigation aids of any kind to guide him. And that's exactly what Neil Armstrong faced when he guided the Eagle to the moon's surface in July 1969. This center's key contribution to that landing and the five that followed was the Lunar Landing Research Vehicle Program. Tomorrow, October 30th, marks the 50th anniversary of the first flight of the first LLRV. Just 5 years separate the LLRV's first flight and the Apollo 11 moon landing. That alone gives us some insight into the pace of the program. In Neil Armstrong's words, the Lunar Landing Research Vehicle was unconventional, sometimes contrary, and always ugly. In September 2007, he gave a lunar landing presentation at the Society of Experimental Test Pilots September 2007 symposium. The center's video crew, who's supporting us here today, was on hand for that event to record it. So we'll begin the first portion of today's program with an encore presentation of Neil Armstrong's Prototyping a Lunar Lander, the LLRV and LLTV projects.
Our theme is prototypes, demonstrating technology, promises, and pitfalls. A research aircraft is a design-for-purpose airplane to go get specific technical knowledge that is then applied in the design of other aircraft. It might be structures, it might be aerothermal, aerodynamics, propulsion, made-for-purpose airplane. The prototype is a pattern, the beginnings of an aircraft that will be produced in quantity and turned over to the average pilot. The distinguishing mark between a research vehicle and a prototype is that they answer a specific operational need. And prototypes have been with us since the beginning of flight. Initially, they were probably more based on imagination of what flight should be than sound aerodynamic principles. But as those principles became known and understood, we began to answer specific operational needs, operational questions. Such things as, how do we lift extremely heavy loads? And are there alternate forms of propulsion that can take us higher and faster? And the holy grail of aviation, how do we marry the vertical flight of a helicopter with the speeds of a fixed-wing aircraft? This is probably the most prototyped and most explored concept in our aviation history. How do we take short-range fighters and escort long-range bombers? And how do we work over vast expanses of ocean without an airfield and repair facilities available to us? Well, these and the seven you're going to hear today have certain common traits to them. The engineers and the pilots knew they were going to operate in an oxygen-nitrogen atmosphere, be subjected to 32.2 feet per second squared pull of gravity. The pilots knew very well their airfield and the surrounding terrain, and they knew they had to make a successful takeoff and landing on that first flight. All of them share this characteristic except one. And suppose you had to build a prototype here on Earth that would not fly in an oxygen-nitrogen atmosphere, would be subjected to only 1/6 the pull of gravity. Your airfield had never been seen or visited by a human being. And to be successful, you had to make a landing followed by a takeoff. Neil A. Armstrong flew 78 combat missions as a naval aviator from the aircraft carrier Essex during the Korean War, and he subsequently served 17 years with NACA and later NASA as an engineer, test pilot, astronaut, and administrator. As a research pilot at NASA's Flight Research Center at Edwards, he flew most of the early supersonic jets, including the X-1, the variable swept wing X-5, the vertical takeoff and landing X-14, and the well-known X-15, which he flew to over 200,000 feet altitude in Mach 5.74. He transferred to astronaut status in 62 and commanded Gemini 8 in 66 when he performed the first successful docking of two vehicles in space. And as spacecraft commander for Apollo 11, he, with colleagues Mike Collins and Buzz Aldrin, completed the first landing mission to the moon. He's been the holder of 13 world records in aviation and space. He received his engineering degrees from Purdue University and University in Southern California. And between 71 and 79, he was professor of aerospace engineering at the University of Cincinnati. He's a member of the National Academy of Engineering and is a fellow and a charter member of this society. So it's my great pleasure to introduce Neil Armstrong to tell us about the Lunar Lander Research Vehicles and the Lunar Lander Training Vehicles. Neil?
Thank you very much. Thank you, Paul. Good morning to all of you. The very first SETP symposium was held precisely one half century minus 1 week ago. On that Saturday, the last day of the conference and the day of the first annual SETP banquet, the Soviets launched Sputnik. Americans were thunderstruck. Almost immediately, here in the U.S., there were serious talks about going to the moon. In the military, in the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, NACA, and in various industry advanced project groups. As a result of testimony that had been given by a variety of experts, Congress was expressing substantial interest. Even before John Kennedy was elected, the House Committee on Science and Astronautics, in their 1960 report, recommended that, quote, a high priority program should be undertaken to place a manned expedition on the moon in this decade, end quote. NASA's 10-year plan at the time was to target a lunar landing after 1970, although their own studies indicated it could be done earlier. Soon after President Kennedy's call to go to the moon in 1961, a number of researchers in government and in industry began to think about the various aspects of a lunar flight. Among them were a few engineers at NASA's Flight Research Center, FRC, now Dryden, at Edwards. Those of us there at the time, like most of the industry, envisaged a multi-stage spacecraft that would depart Earth orbit, fly to and land on the moon, take off, and then return directly to Earth. A primary question of the time was to whether to use one large rocket booster of the proposed Nova class, about the size and no doubt the weight of the Empire State Building, or to use a number of smaller rockets to launch parts of the spacecraft into Earth orbit where they would be assembled and fueled prior to departure. In either case, the configuration of the craft to be landed on the surface was unknown, but assumed to be large. In order to obtain experience here on Earth in landing such a large machine on the moon, the initial Flight Research Center idea was to build a craft that would carry the actual lunar landing craft or a replica of it. The carrier craft would include those systems which would compensate for the change in gravity and atmosphere, permitting the spacecraft to simulate free flight lunar descents and landings. It was an impractical idea, considering the fact that no one knew what the spacecraft would look like. In January of 1962, FRC proposed a free flight lunar landing simulator program, consisting of three parts: a preliminary study, a research test vehicle, and an Apollo flight simulator. The research test vehicle would be small, relatively inexpensive, and independent of the actual Apollo configuration. It was intended to investigate the inherent problems of lunar descents from an altitudes of up to 2,000 feet, and have the capacity to vary control characteristics, cockpit configuration, displays, and landing gear geometry, and so on. They considered a helicopter and a lunar vehicle of the same mass over Earth in the helicopter, and if there were no drag, the horizontal component of acceleration would be approximately proportional to the tilt angle of the rotor. Over the moon, where there is definitely no drag, and weight is only 1/6 of Earth, the same amount of acceleration requires nearly 6 times the tilt angle. The proposed technique for simulating the lunar gravity was simple in principle. Reduce the apparent weight of the craft to its value while flying over the moon. The proposed method: install a jet engine underneath or within the machine on gimbals, so the thrust was always vertically upward. The engine thrust would then be adjusted so that the craft's net weight, that is its gross weight minus the engine thrust, would equal its lunar equivalent. Traversing large pitch or roll angles, of course, requires either more time or more control power. It was suspected that the control characteristics that were ideal here on Earth may not be at all acceptable over the moon. The force required to lift the net weight would be provided by throttleable rockets. With the proposed 1-year construction time and a 2-year flight test program, it was believed that the results could significantly assist the design team at North American Aviation, who had just won the contract for the Apollo spacecraft a few months earlier. In the proposed third phase, an Apollo landing simulator would be constructed based on the flight test results from the research vehicle and the developing configuration of the Apollo spacecraft. It would, of course, also be a free-flying machine used to develop procedures and techniques and equipment and, of course, be used for Apollo crew training. The research test vehicle was estimated to cost about $2.5 million and a full-blown Apollo simulator about $12. At that same time, at NASA's Langley Research Center in Virginia, a small group of engineers, including John Hubble, were devising a new concept, lunar orbit rendezvous. It was a revolutionary idea, using only one big rocket to launch two spacecraft modules, one designed for flying from the Earth to lunar orbit and around the moon and then back to Earth, a second lightweight craft designed specifically from descending to the lunar, from lunar orbit to landing on the moon, returning to lunar orbit, and then be discarded. Considering that the United States had not even put a man into orbit, the idea of rendezvousing two separate manned machines in lunar orbit was thought by many to be ludicrous. But the advantages were tempting. No requirement to launch that monster, build that monster Nova rocket. No requirement to launch a fleet of rockets. No requirement to assemble the lunar machine in Earth orbit. Perhaps most importantly, a potential two-year saving in reaching the end of the decade goal and about $2 billion in cost. By the summer of 62, the lunar orbit rendezvous technique and its resultant new vehicle, the Lunar Excursion Module, had been approved. In November, Grumman on Long Island was selected to design and build the LEM. Apparently, the word excursion was regarded by some as sounding too much like a holiday and was deleted from the designation. LEM was still pronounced the same way, but its acronym was now just LM. 3 months later, on the other end of New York State, in Buffalo, Bell Aerosystems was awarded a contract to design and build two lunar landing research vehicles. As the LEM was not yet designed, there could be no attempt to match its configuration. Once it was decided to use the lunar module specifically for the descent and landing job, the research requirements were much more easily focused. The general configuration converged rapidly, and teams at both NASA and Grumman began laboratory simulations of the control characteristics, touchdown accuracy, visibility, and display requirements. The early simulations were universally done on analog computers. Digital machines of the time were far too slow for flight simulations in real time. The first lunar flying simulations were conducted using helicopters. Unfortunately, they were incapable of investigating the problems of most concern. They could neither replicate the consequences of lunar gravity nor the handling qualities of reaction control systems on those kind of machines. They could approximate a range of final descent trajectories, but that often required flying for substantial periods on the wrong side of the dead man's curve. The X-14 might be a useful simulator, some thought, although it could not duplicate the effects of reduced gravity, its reaction control system was quite variable and could replicate a wide variety of control characteristics that were directly applicable to lunar flight. Some lunar final approach simulations were performed in early 1964, but without the lunar gravity characteristics, they were of limited usefulness. Independently, at NASA's Langley Research Center, an alternate approach to lunar simulation was initiated. The Lunar Landing Research Facility, LLRF, looked like a dirigible hangar after a tornado. Again, the idea was to duplicate the lunar gravity and control characteristics. The method was to lower the vehicle apparent weight to its lunar equivalent by lifting upward with a vertical cable attached to a traveling bridge crane. A complex electro-hydraulic system kept the crane platform directly over the machine and the cables vertical with an upward force equal to 5/6 of the vehicle weight. It had a wonderful assortment of structural and cable stretch and pendulous frequencies requiring innovative compensation networks. It was indeed an engineer's delight. After the kinks were worked out, it worked reasonably well. The flying volume, 180 feet high, 360 feet long, and 42 feet wide, was limiting, but it was adequate to give pilots a substantive introduction to the lunar flight characteristics. Because the cable system could be frozen at any time, it did permit flying into marginal conditions that would not be attempted in a free flight vehicle. At Buffalo, the LLRV, the Lunar Landing Research Vehicle, was taking shape, but encountering significant cost overruns. NASA FRC was unable to get enough money from the Apollo program, and so it happened that the components were shipped to Edwards, and the NASA team, with some assistance from Bell, assembled the vehicle, installed the systems, and performed the component and systems checkouts. As flight operations neared, they moved the entire operation to Edwards South Base, where there would be a minimum of ground and airborne congestion. The first flight of the LLRV in October of 64 was flown by Joe Walker. First liftoff was what you might call tentative. The second was considerably smoother. On the third, a failure in the control system electronics put the machine in backup mode, creating limit cycling in all axes. The offending relay was replaced, and that failure never reoccurred. On the second flight, a manhole cover lifted and sailed by the LLRV struts, leg struts, as it was flying over. The manhole covers were soon welded down in the flight test area. During the following year, Joe Walker and Don Malik flew about 150 development flights, expanding the flight envelope and investigating the adequacy of the design and the systems. And they had a myriad of flight control configurations that were possible. Early flights had casters on the landing gear, but the wind would push the machine around on the ramp, and the casters had no brakes, so they were later replaced with foot pads. This is usually the part of a flight test program when the unexpected is commonplace. The LLRV was no exception. Modifying or fine-tuning the various systems was a common occurrence. The devil was in the detail. The autothrottle needed to know the vehicle's instantaneous weight, so accuracy of the onboard system to weigh the machine in flight was critical. That turned out to be complicated. EMI was a problem, and devising appropriate electronic filters was an everyday job. The aerodynamic drag compensation was contrary. Uneven feeding from the lift rocket propellant tanks created roll unbalances, which were solved with a unique roll trim system. It took a year to get the kinks rolled out. The flying bedstead could be flown as a conventional VTOL, if there is any such thing, with the jet engine gimbals locked in position and the jet engine providing all the lift. The engine was a vertically configured version of the GE CF700, a J85 core fitted with an aft fan. It had 4,200 pounds of thrust at 87 degrees Fahrenheit, which provided a thrust-to-weight ratio of 1.05. On hot days at Edwards, the thrust-to-weight dropped below 1, and the lift was delayed until some fuel was burned off. But the turbofan performed flawlessly throughout the entire program. In the lunar simulation mode, the engine, mounted in a double gimbal, was aligned to the local vertical and thrust automatically adjusted to reduce the apparent weight of the LLRV to its lunar equivalent. The engine's angle could additionally be modulated to compensate for aerodynamic drag and the throttle adjusted to counteract vertical drag. When in the lunar simulation mode, lift was provided by a pair of throttleable 500-pound max thrust rockets fixed to the fuselage outside the gimbal ring. The monopropellant was a 90% solution of hydrogen peroxide. In the lunar simulation mode, as you can see, the engine is aligned approximately with the local vertical. Pilots generally preferred flying in the VTOL, or Earth mode, because of the ability to start and stop translation rates with small attitude changes. Decelerating in the lunar simulation mode, conversely, was like trying to stop a downhill putt on a fast green. Uncontrollably large attitudes were required for reasonable decelerations. Altitude control, on the other hand, was very much better in lunar simulation. Response time for the jet engine throttle changes was about 1 second, while the lift rocket's response was only 24 milliseconds, providing very crisp control. The LLRV cockpit was outfitted with the conventional stick and rudder pedals, a standard console throttle for the jet engine, and a collective stick for the lift rockets. The attitude control system was a dual fly-by-wire system. To the best of my knowledge, it was the first fly-by-wire system that did not have a mechanical backup. There was also a dual set of attitude control thrusters, which could be ground-adjusted, giving a wide range of control power. Stick and rudder deflection in the primary mode could command angular acceleration, angular rate, or attitude. Obvious to everyone here, having the CG located on the engine centerline was highly desirable. Out of balance conditions could only be compensated by attitude thruster firings. Similarly, as airspeed increased, the drag and the aerodynamic moments would increase and flight control system would have to work harder and harder to counteract them. That meant the attitude rockets were firing more and more frequently. Warning lights would indicate to the pilot when roll attitude thrusters were firing excessively, and flight controllers on the ground would radio warnings when telemetry indicated that the thrusters reached 80% of saturation. The pilot would then slow down to reduce aerodynamic moment and could activate both attitude control systems if required. As you all know, if you want cool temperatures and calm winds in the desert, early morning is the time to fly. It was perfect for the LLRV. High thrust and smooth air. The lunar landing research activity was conducted in 1966. Don Malik and Jack Kluver flew about 50 flights, many of which focused on determining the optimum control characteristics of the lunar module. LLRV flights demonstrated that much lower control powers were acceptable than had been expected based on VTOL experience. It was a welcome surprise because low control powers result in low attitude control propellant consumption and weight. Other investigations delve more deeply in how to minimize aerodynamic effects, an evaluation of various final descent trajectories in the lunar simulation mode, and various cockpit and control changes to make it more compatible with the lunar module. Don Malik and Jack Kluver at the 10th SCTP symposium 41 years ago gave a paper on this work. To my knowledge, that was the last SCTP paper given on the program and possibly the last in any professional society. In their concluding remarks, they said, quote, "The value of the LLRV for lunar landing simulation seems to be unexcelled," end quote. And that completed the development and research phases of the program. The 204 flights had accumulated 16.8 hours of flight time, an average about 5 minutes per flight. It was time to put the machines to work doing what they were hoped they could do, preparing Apollo crews to make successful lunar landings. The machines were moved to the NASA Manned Spacecraft Center's flight operations at Ellington Air Force Base in Houston. During 1965 and 66, it was increasingly obvious that there was a need for a trainer that was more consistent with the lunar module, whose physical characteristics were now becoming established. Building a lunar module that would fly on Earth like a LLRV was possible, but prohibitively time-consuming and expensive. Serendipitously, the LLRV, although predating the lunar module, was not all that different in physical size and control rocket geometry. An advanced version of the LLRV, modified to match the LEM characteristics, could be built relatively cheaply and quickly. And so the Lunar Landing Training Vehicle, or LLTV, was born. It featured a partially enclosed cockpit with a LEM-like visibility, a three-axis control mounted side stick, a lift rocket throttle replacing the collective, LEM displays, a rate command attitude hold system that closely approximated the expected lunar module performance. The LLTV proved to be an excellent simulator and was highly regarded by the Apollo lunar module crews as necessary to lunar landing preparation. But it was unforgiving. Three of the vehicles were lost, one due to a loss of propellant pressurizing gas, one when wind shear produced aerodynamic rolling moments that control system couldn't handle, and one due to a primary electric system failure where the switch over to the backup system failed. The Weber ejection seat could operate successfully at zero altitude with a 30 foot per second downward vertical velocity, the best performance of any seat up to that time. NASA management was forever worried about the reliability and safety of these machines and continually wanted to shut them down. But the pilots insisted they were vital to lunar landing preparation, and they prevailed. The LLTV flight syllabus for Apollo commanders was typically 22 flights, beginning with gimbal-locked hover and transition, then flights with the turbofan aligned to the local vertical, then increasingly difficult final approaches to landing in the full lunar simulation mode with the control power and rate command attitude hold system matching the lunar module. Typically, the pilot took off with the gimbals locked, flew out to the inner marker, which in this case was about 400 to 500 feet altitude, about a quarter of a mile from the intended touchdown spot. Arriving at the IP, he began a descent toward the target, switched into the lunar simulation mode, energized the lift rockets, and practiced a lunar landing. Often, They would change the desired touchdown point in mid-approach to add more complexity to the task. I was most fortunate to be involved throughout the entire lunar flying development, beginning with the Lunar Research Test Vehicle proposed in 1961. I had the pleasure of flying every one of the machines, the helicopters, the X-14A, the LLRF, the ground-based simulators, the LLRV, the LLTV, the lunar module, and even the Weber ejection seat, the last not by choice. Now the United States is planning to return to the moon. Perhaps, as Jeff Williams reported yesterday, as early as 2018 or shortly thereafter. And when that craft is on final approach to that flat-tipped rock ridge near Shackleton Crater, I hope that the person at the controls has a simulation experience that is at least as good as the LLTV provided the Apollo crews a half century later. Thank you.
So that's the first part of today's program. We've had a member of the original LLRV team join us. I'd like to introduce to you Mr. Adam Mello. And Adam was the contract negotiator who in June of 1964 wrote the contract for Bell Aerospace to acquire the LLRV. And he brought a notebook with him that had a lot of his memorabilia. And what I thought was interesting was on the front of that was the issue of the Express that showed him reporting to work here on the center. And that was dated March of 1964. So he got here in March, and in June he was writing that contract. So it obviously took him a long time to get up to speed. So Adam, thank you for joining us today. And some other guests I'd like to recognize in the back there. We have seats in the front if anybody would like to come up and fill in. There's plenty of time to move around here. Masten Space Systems operates in Mojave, California. 5 years ago, in October 2009, they won the $1 million Northrop Grumman Lunar Lander XPRIZE challenge. And that was with an autonomous vertical takeoff and vertical landing rocket. That's the look ma, no hands version of the LLRV and LLTV. And so with us today, Ruben Garcia, are you back there? Ruben, thanks for coming. Nathan Koenig and Ben DeGong. Did I get the name right? Okay, good. Would you like to come and sit up front here? The view's better. Okay, good enough. For the next portion of this, we're going to have our panel members join us. First, an administrative note for anybody who's out viewing remotely from Building 703 in Palmdale or wherever. You can email questions in for the panel to john.kelly@nasa.gov. This is John sitting in the front row. john.kelly@nasa.gov for anybody who wants to email a question in. And at this time, we'll have our panel members come up and start to join us. First is Don Malik. Don was a research pilot with the NASA Flight Research Center from 1963 until 1981. He later became deputy chief for the Dryden Aircraft Operations Division. He became chief pilot in 1967. During the mid-1960s, he was the chief project pilot on NASA's Lunar Landing Research Vehicle, the LLRV. And as you can see, it helped to develop the piloted landing procedures that were used in Apollo. Don Malik joined NASA's predecessor, the NACA, in 1957 and retired here from the center in 1987. So Don, would you like to come up and have a seat? And our next panel member is Gene Matranga. Gene came to work here at Edwards in 1954 when this was called the NACA High Speed Flight Station. Gene Matranga was a project engineer and then a project manager for the LLRV. He retired from NASA in 1979 as the director of projects and went to work for the Lockheed Advanced Development Projects Group. Huell Hauser featured both Gene and Don Malik in the Lunar Lander episode of California's Gold, the television series, and that still airs. So Gene, would you like to come up and join us? Gene is a co-author. Gene is the co-author of the NASA History Monograph on the LLRV, Unconventional, Contrary, and Ugly, the Lunar Landing Research Vehicle. And again, that goes back to Neil Armstrong's description of the vehicle. Our next panel member is Wayne Ottinger. In 1960, he joined the Flight Research Center as the X-15 Propulsion Flight Operations Engineer and became the LLRV Project Engineer and later the Bell Aerosystems Plant Representative for the design and build in 1963. And the flight operations until 1966. He then became the technical director for Bell Aerosystems on the LLTV, the Lunar Landing Training Vehicle, during the early testing at Ellington Field, starting in 1967 through late 1968. So Wayne, would you join us? And Wayne is also a co-author of Unconventional, Contrary, and Ugly, the Lunar Landing Research Vehicle. And that's, again, a NASA history monograph. That's available online if you haven't seen it. And completing our panel for today is Dave Stoddard. Dave Stoddard came here in December 1961. He accepted as a position as a rocket engine technician at the NASA Flight Research Center. He was assigned to the rocket engine shop under the supervision of Jack Russell. Some of the research programs he participated in are the X-15, and the M2, the HL-10, and the X-24 lifting bodies, and the LLRV. And that was followed by a long list of projects that didn't have any rocket engines. He retired here from the center in May of 1984. Dave, could you join us on stage? So again, for write-in questions, that's john.kelly@nasa.gov. So the first question that I'd like to start with here is for Don Malik. And Neil Armstrong once said that these vehicles had more degrees of freedom than an octopus. And so we'd be very interested in hearing what it was like to fly a vehicle like the LLRV.
Well, I was going to answer first on the selection, Cam. I came out to Edwards in 1963 from Langley, and I'd been flying variety back there, a lot of VCOL, a lot of helicopter. And so when I reported at Edwards, Joe Walker sent me over to the test pilot school, which was a great opportunity. And when I come back to the office one day, he called me in, he said, "Now, Don, you're back. We have some primary programs here. I'd like to know what you're interested in." And to diverge a little bit, on the pilot selection in our office, there was normally a project pilot and a co-project pilot. And the reason being, if somebody was sick or traveling or something like that, a mission would go on. There'd be a pilot there to fly it. And so that was a normal setup. And assignments to these programs depended on a number of things. One was seniority, which was obvious in most offices. One was background, what you had in your background. And one was, of course, need, what programs were there. But in any case, Joe Walker said to me, "What we have three programs, Don. We have X-15, which was sort of phasing down from its effort. In fact, Joe was leaving the X-15 program, and he was going to be the project pilot in the LLRV. And we had the B-70, he said, and we have the LLRV. And I said, "Well, he said, "What would be your order of preference?" And I said, "Well, I'd like to fly the X-15 first, and then the B-70 and the LLRV." So he signed me to the LLRV. But I wasn't really surprised, because I was one of the few guys in the office that had much V2L time. In fact, his Joe didn't have a lot, and he went through some Navy helicopter training and preparation. He did a super job on the program, but that's how I was assigned.
Okay, the next question is for Gene Matranga. Gene, you were you were there early on as the assistant project manager and then the project manager. Can you talk about the decision to move to South Base and also comment on how the project management for the LLRV was different from the rest of the center?
When we started, we recognized that we were flying in a totally different environment than most of the airplanes flying in the area. So we said we'd best find a place where we don't get in anybody's way. The logical place to go was South Base. It had essentially been abandoned by the Air Force at the time. There were some runway rejection tests that were being done down there off and on again. But other than that, the only other occupant on South Base was the Aero Club for the local people. So we got permission to go down and use the South Base. We towed down there back and forth several times to do that, and that turned out to be a big deal that didn't seem to be very necessary. So we got permission to operate completely down at South Base, and we were, Paul Bickel, the director at the time, gave us the autonomy to go down, have a dedicated crew of people, and operate essentially autonomously, and we did that. Local management wasn't particularly enthused about that, but the boss said, go do it, so we did. It meant that I made the decisions, and along with Don Bellman, who was the project manager at the time, and the maintenance people like Wayne and Bob Barron were able to do what they needed to do independent of what was dictated up here. So it turned out to be a very pleasing arrangement for most everybody because we didn't have a lot of people second-guessing us. There weren't a lot of people that knew what we were doing, cared what we were doing, and we were able to operate on our own, and it was a nice feeling.
Thank you. A question for Wayne. From Neil's presentation, we could see that there were a lot of competing ideas going on out there for what was necessary for the Apollo program and who should build what kind of a tool to help prepare. How did the LLRV survive the competitive fight for funding and priority in astronaut training for the lunar landings?
Well, it began, I think, when I was at Bell during the design build phase. Bell had lost some contracts, and since ours was a cost plus contract, our monies were dependent on their overhead rate and so forth, which was rising. And Paul Bickel was intent on not going back and asking for more money. And so I became the team leader at the Bell plant to work with them and decide what could we do not to exceed the ceiling that they had originally bid on. And so as a result, we built the structure, did the components and the necessary qual tests on the components. But when we brought it out, we didn't have any wiring on it. We had no rocket or jet plumbing on it. We're going to do that all out here in our shop. We saved a lot of money. Without the help, though, of a lot of the Bell people, I brought about 20 Bell people out, TDY. Some of them stayed over a year. But Bert Adams comes to mind, who maintained our drawings. But we arrived in April with both vehicles coming in semi-truck and disassembled. And from April till October, end of October, however many months that is, pretty short compared to today's bureaucrats, we did the installation of all the wiring, the plumbing, set up all the system tests, had to make some structural modifications because as we did, I can remember having to beef up the mainframe, so forth and so on. But we also tried to avoid any tether test. So we made closed-loop hot firing tests on two different innovative fixtures and got in the air safely on October 30th, 1964. And we did limit cycle in yaw on that first flight, and Cal Jarvis and I were talking the other day. He said, well, I thought we did limit cycle on all three, but as Neil's tape shows, I think it was a second or third flight that we had a limit cycle on all three. But
In backup.
Okay. Anyway, back the funding and competitions, we had the MIT black box people, and they don't need astronauts controlling the landing. Thank goodness with Neil and others, they fought hard, but it still was a funding problem all the way through and late on getting started. And they wanted to train down at the Cape just the day before launch. We could never touch that. We had such a short, due to some accidents and so forth, our availability of flight training time was very critical. Neil only had, I think, 7 or 8 flights 1 month before he launched in the LLTV, which was upgraded for the highest quality simulator. He had had some flights in the LLRV earlier before we had lost it down there. Anyway, we'll go on.
Thank you. A question for Dave. So you were running the rocket shop. Can you describe what the work environment was like and what the precautions were for handling the materials?
Yes. I worked under Jack Russell in rocket shop, and as I remember the program when it came out, it was a big kit, and there's a lot of work. And one of the things that we did, I don't think it was ever done here before, but we had to do some plumbing in the hydrogen peroxide system, and Jack had to. We had to keep the weight down on the vehicle. So Jack bought some tubing, and he got this tubing, and it was usually you get tubing. It's you bend it on a machine, and you have to put a mandrel in it, and this tubing Jack bought was it was highly polished inside, which would great for hydrogen peroxide. It was a 347 series, and I asked Jack, I said, I have heard about bending tubing. Instead of using a mandrel, pressurize the tubing and then bend it over the radius block. So Jack said, give her a go. So we fixed up a deal. We flared each end of the tubing and we bent it, and it worked out very good, and it saved a lot of time for passivating the tubing for the hydrogen peroxide system. I think that working on that program and in other programs here, the ingenuity, a lot of the technicians that worked on it did a great service to the people. And I got to say that one of the persons on this program was Ray White. Ray White was a superb crew chief, one of the best. And Ray White used to, when you were working on this project, he was kind of looking over your shoulder to make sure you were doing things right. And I remember one program working with Ray. Ray was doing his work on his books, and I was working on one of his aircraft, and Ray looked up and saw somebody working on this particular vehicle, and Ray went over and said, hey, what are you doing? He says, oh, I am taking this black box. And Ray says, you're taking that black box? Where are you going with it? And the guy says, well, we got to work on it. And I says, Ray says, you ain't going to take that black box to my aircraft. This was Ray. And this is the way he ran his program. So Ray, he was on top of that. So I think a great respect should be paid to guys like Ray that really made these programs work.
Can I add a quickie about Ray and Frosty, our Inspector Leroy Frost? We were all back in the Bell plant during the final days of getting ready to ship it out here. And Ray had just gotten married before he came back to Buffalo or Niagara Falls. And so we had a teletype system, and Frosty and I set up an extension of his TDY to stay another 3 months. And this was, I think, on his birthday. And, we had lots of fun. But the German lady in the motel would make us dinner and birthday cake. Oh, we had a great time.
Make another comment to add to all of this, relating to the original question for me. Most of the people that were assigned to the program were people who were relatively new to the center. Aerospace was laying people off at the time, and we had the good fortune of picking up people like Leroy Frost and Ray White and some of the others. They were unknowns to the center, but they were very quality people. And as it turns out, I got the best of the best.
Thanks. A question for Don. Were there any close calls that you remember from flying the LLRV?
I had one. I think all test pilots over their careers experience a few incidents that water their eyes. Hopefully they're not accidents, and it wasn't an accident in my case, but it sure watered my eyes. It was into the program for some flights, and I felt pretty experienced in the machine, pretty comfortable with it at that time. And I was in lunar simulation coming in for a landing, and I was evaluating a minimal roll and pitch control attitude rockets. That was one of our chores or jobs, was to determine just how low a power you had to have in attitude control to land on the moon. And both Walker and I were evaluating these different levels and rating them and trying to come up with what we felt was a good minimum. But in any event, we had a backup set of control rockets, which was good planning and design. So we could always switch over to those if we had some problem or emergency with the test rockets. And the test rockets that we were looking at, even though they were low powered, they were working. And I was coming in on this approach for landing and coming through about 30 feet, I was doing my final flare, which is pretty high attitude and pitch to stop your motion. And all at once, the machine just started to roll to the right on me, and I had full control, roll to the left. I had full control into the right, and I didn't know what was happening. Well, I dashed over to the console and immediately switched into both rockets, attitude rockets, which gave me much more power, which allowed me to roll it level about 20 feet and get it on the ground. And so when I sat down on the ground, I thought, well, where did that come from? You know, but we had a lot of good data and a lot of information from the monitors on it. And it turned out that the hydrogen peroxide fuel that I was burning with the lift rockets and the attitude rockets and coming in, we didn't really have that much excess. But when we came into this flare, I had burned out only one tank, and the left tank had not fed very much hydrogen peroxide. And we went further into the data, and they came to me and they said, Don, you had your thumb on the trim switch, and on our lift stick, our collective stick, there was a little rocker switch left and right, and it was designed if you felt that you were having too much asymmetric roll in flight, you could trim that fuel a little bit and manage. Well, I'd never used it in all the flight. I knew it was there, but up to that point, we never really experienced any problem. But it sort of shook me up because I thought, why in the world did I do that with the stick? Because my hand went down in this collective and my thumb was right up over the end of that. Well, after a little bit of thought, I remembered that the Weber Seat Company, who had put us in slings, these ejection seats that you saw in the movie that Neil had there. The Weber seat was excellent. Had a big rocket on it, and like he said, you could be near 400 foot per minute rate of descent right near the ground, and if you hit the switch, it would carry you away from that and get you up and get you under a good parachute. But we had to have a critical CG for the pilot, because that rocket, if it didn't come right up through your seat and body CG, you'd go up in the air rolling and possibly roll up in your chute. That would be bad. And so you had a real critical seat cushion height. And for some reason, Weber went through a recalculation, and a week or two before, they brought me another seat cushion, and it was a lot thicker than the other one. And so I got back in the machine, and I looked, and where my hand had fit on that collective stick below that trim switch comfortably before, now my hand was up right at the end of that stick, and the spring loading on that thing was very light. That was changed later. But that's what really caught me, and it was very close, and it could have been catastrophic for me and the machine. But it's sort of a example of what something small like that could get up and catch you in flying.
Thank you. A question for Gene. Whose idea was the LLRV in the first place?
The idea was fundamentally that of Jake Drake, Hubert M. Jake Drake. He was in charge of long-range planning at the center. And he had been pushing for orbital flight in the mid-1950s when I arrived. He was already talking about having things go into orbit, and talked to the people in headquarters, and they said, oh, you're 10, 15 years ahead of your time. Come back and talk to us in another 10 years. But he was thinking all the time, and when the decision was made that we were going to go to the moon, he immediately had his mind cranking away at it and came up with this idea that we need some sort of vehicle that would be able to duplicate the airless environment and the gravity environment on the moon. And he talked about a gimbaled vehicle that we would use to do that. He also was very influential with headquarters and with the people in the Space Task Group in making the decision to go from a single stage to orbit to going to the in-Earth orbit to the moon, so that you have the LEM instead of this direct flight there. So he was very influential within the agency as well as here in the center. And he was a very, most people obviously have never heard of him because it's been a long time ago, but he was the brains behind that.
Thanks. Wayne, there was a transition between the LLRV and the LLTV. Can you describe what it was like at Bell going from one platform to the other and what the changes were?
Well, when I first arrived at Bell, the cockpit was on top of the engine, and it was a very tall vehicle and very unstable, air inlet distortion problems. And so about 5 months into the contract, we came up with the forward cockpit location. And as I recall, about that summer of 63, and I may be off a year because I noticed in the video Neil talked about LOR being in 1962, but I thought it was summer of 63, halfway through our design build. And anyway, Grumman, I think, got their contract for the LEM in December of 63. And by that time, we were almost ready to deliver. And so when it came time to get the LLTVs built, I started writing the model spec. And with Gene's help, I did most of the work. But I think as I transferred down to Bell as technical director in June, I arrived at Bell just the Monday after Joe was killed in the B-70. Accident. But basically, we used the Apollo sidearm controller, the actual Apollo hardware, and the T-handle controller for lift control. We removed the circuit in the avionics to weigh the vehicle because we could predict the weight for a projected accurate training syllabus because we knew what we did. So there were several things that we could simplify, but we added a little larger peroxide tank so we could get a little more fuel. And the wind shear was always a problem. That's The first LLTV was lost because of that. But I would say that, we had a slightly different orientation in the firing logic between the LLTV and the LLRV, but it was insignificant in terms of the control.
Probably one of the most significant differences, the LLRV was analog. The LLTV was digital.
Yes.
I think on one insignificant system, I think on the electrical system that actually GE, our second LLTV crash was caused by a product improvement GE sold us on their DC generator on the fan jet engine. And we actually had a generator failure, but the hidden defect that we didn't know about was that new improved generator had a much longer residual magnetic field during the failure mode, and that prevented the switchover circuit from our battery bus from working. And Stu Present, who had to eject with that successfully, he was killed in the very next year in a T-38 accident. Houston was quite a busy place, and lots of lives lost down there with astronauts and T-38s and helicopter crashes.
Thank you.
In those days.
A question for Dave Stoddard. In looking at the video, we see the thrusters firing, and that looks like a nice friendly cloud of steam coming out of those jets. But those were fueled by hydrogen peroxide that was very highly concentrated. What impact did that have on your operations in the rocket shop?
Well, the 90% hydrogen peroxide was pretty rough propellant. Because everybody working in the vicinity of the vehicle were given rubber boots to put it on, because the first thing you kept the area washed down with water, plenty of water. It was neutralized. But during the process of the program there, Ray White would come to me and he'd say, "Dave, we got some people here that don't understand how dangerous hydrogen peroxide, and we need to give a little demonstration." He said, "Well, when you when we drain the tanks from the vehicle after a flight," he says, "let's have a little demonstration." So one particular person seemed to want to carry a pair of leather gloves that were not too compatible with hydrogen peroxide. So Ray would give a little demonstration. He'd say, grab the crew all together, and he said, "We're going to have a little demonstration of the danger of hydrogen peroxide." So he grabbed these gloves from this particular person and he dropped it on the concrete, and he asked me to pour a little peroxide on him, so I'd pour a little peroxide on him, and everybody would stand around and look at it, and say, "Huh." And all of a sudden, it would flame up, and you had a fire. So old Malik flying these things, he was flying a bomb with the peroxide and then the JP, which was a good propellant mixture. So it was people that worked on the airplane that had to work with the peroxide system ended up, if they had to do some disassembly of the system, always ended up with a bunch of white hands. It really, really got to your skin. And another demonstration that we used to do, just guys, we'd take a dime just in the rocket shop, put a dime down and put some peroxide on it. And the old dime would sit there and jump up and down like that. That's how much silver in the peroxide reaction. So it was pretty bad stuff to work with, but we had correct colloquium and everything. And I don't think on that program there was anybody that ever had any injuries, but we did on the X-15. Burnt up a few shoes and stuff like that. Very dangerous.
I have a quickie on Don's near accident, which was partially my fault. Our gimbal, our two gimbals for pitch and roll 40 degrees in each direction, our original throttle control for the jet throttle was teleflex cables. And the first few flights, we fought lots of friction. And so one of Charlie Lynn in the machine shop, who built a 1/3 scale Mustang and flew it, he had a World War II fighter hydraulic throttle system in his bench. And so we slapped it on and started flying with it. And we got out there on a cold morning, and Don's fired up the engine, and the power cart is still hooked up, but we're ready to disconnect and let him take off. Well, all of a sudden, after he starts, the engine comes up to 90%, and he has no control over it at all, and the vehicle's up on its struts, straining, and here we are still connected to the ground support equipment. So one of our jet mechanic, Willie, he ran in, and by the way, you've got pretty good, you're down close to the pavement with the jet exhaust. But he runs in with a pair of dykes, cuts a safety wire in the main fuel control on the engine, and manually shuts the engine down. And thank goodness Don was okay.
Yeah, that one didn't scare me as much as the one in the air when I rolled. But I knew there were problems out there because I whacked the throttle off, cut off right away as soon as that RPM was going up, and I felt it get lighter, and I wasn't ready to go. And so I whacked the throttle off, nothing happened. So, I got to wait. And I knew they were out there doing something, and pretty soon it quit.
Have we got one more minute for Joe Walker's problem? Flying for the 500 people out here on the back of the building?
Yes, go ahead.
We had an AIAA, I think, demonstration with about 500 people. We didn't want to haul them down to South Base. So we pulled all the ramps down, or the lights down off of the ramp. And we were down here a week ahead of time getting all set up. And Joe made a practice flight or two behind the buildings there. So on the real day, we had in the RV in the early days, we had this in-flight weighing system with accelerometers and so forth, and so we could actually weigh the vehicle. But it had dynamic characteristics and such that you had to have the lift stick at a particular stroke rate. And if you didn't do it just right, it would weigh it too light. So the throttle would come back, your sink rate would go up, and you had to abort. Well, sure enough, on this flight, at about 50 feet, Joe had to abort because the sink rate was building up too much. And so I got up in the cockpit right after he landed and congratulated him. And he said, change the blankety-blank switch, because we'd had a big argument. The XB-5A, the Army was flight testing a month before, had a fatal accident. And it was blamed on a switch that was critical in the transition, and it was behind the pilot, and he hit the wrong switch. And it crashed, and he died. And we had what I thought was a similar problem, and I've been fighting Joe all this time to get it changed so that we wouldn't have a problem with it down on the console panel, and we wanted to put it up on top of the jet throttle. Well, I examined the data afterwards. Joe had made about 4 switch actuations within 2 seconds to make that transition. And it calculated out it was right at the margin of human reaction. But he didn't have to study the data. He said, go ahead and put the switch up there on that jet throttle. But that was a... But the crowd didn't know any difference. They thought it was a great flight.
Good optics. So we haven't gotten any write-in questions, John tells me. Scott, you have a question there.
What was the highest altitude that the LRV or TV achieved?
Kluver took it up.
I was going to say, Jack Kluver, toward the end of the program, as we were gearing down, getting ready to send to Houston, we got up to about 10,000 feet. This is on the jet engine alone, not using the lift rockets.
In my STEM lectures, I challenged some university students to help us calculate Jane's memory of 10,000 feet versus some other projections of maybe 5,000 feet. Jack himself said it was over 5,000 feet, but that's the best he could recollect. I did some things to challenge some university students to take some of the jet engine fuel rates and other factors and come up with a best guess of maybe 7,000 or something, just to argue with Jane here.
memories.
For the normal testing and development, we very seldom went over 1,000 feet. In fact, as I recall, we like to use 800 feet as a max because we were working under the Air Force traffic, the jets that were coming, breaking overhead and going over us for landing. So, and we had guaranteed the tower we were going to stay below that and not get into their traffic. And we're doing the last sim down the last 500 feet or so. So that worked out well for us, where we were operating, like Gene had mentioned, South Base was sort of ideal. We were sort of underneath everything and able to function like that. And when Jack took it up, I think he was just looking for sort of an altitude record. He was just going up.
He put on a heck of a show down at Houston for the astronauts when he was the project manager in the Pentagon, I think, on the one of the advanced helicopters.
The AH-56, okay. Lockheed's rigid rotor helicopter.
And they gave him permission to go down and fly the LLRV at that time because we hadn't delivered the LLTVs yet. I was up in Niagara Falls. Wasn't able to see it, but I understand he put on quite a show for the astronauts with the LLRV.
Okay, we have another question.
The original question of what was it like to fly?
Well, that might take a while, but I had a good background in helicopters and a few VTOLs at Langley, so that gave me a pretty good basis. But this machine was completely different, and with the fly-by-wire and the rocket attitude control systems and the computerized damping and everything, it was a brand new experience. And the first thing that sort of struck me as different when you sat in it, if you look at the picture, it seems like you were just there by yourself. There wasn't much up there with you. In a helicopter, there was a canopy bow over you and something in front of you and everything, but in the LLRV, you really got the feeling you might have been sitting at the end of a telegraph pole and you weren't sure what was behind you coming along. But there was a lot behind it, the computer and the servos and everything like that. On the first liftoff I made in it, I was amazed at all the noise and the recirculation and everything from the engine and the rockets firing. And the attitude rockets, they were spitting and firing all the time, and there were little particles of peroxide that were not completely decomposed. And we found out real early we better get a scarf because we had flight suits on, Nomex, fire protection. We had boots on, protection, but helmets. But around our neck, it was getting in, and Joe and I were both coming back with little burn spots on our neck. So we immediately got onto the silk scarf thing to protect us. But with that, when you lift up, you bring up the jet engine throttle, you're really coming up on a V2L mode. We didn't ever take off in a lunar simulation mode. That was for the approach and landing. But we take off in a V2L mode, and the engine was putting out max power. Some mornings, if it was warm, you'd even wait until you burn a little fuel off. I had a couple of them where I'd come up on the oleos, and I thought, well, I don't want it to fly anyway because I don't have enough positive thrust to get away from the ground where I want to be. But the recirculation and all the peroxide going on, and if it was a cold morning, a lot of it was steam. I got the feeling, and I commented before, instead of flying a vehicle, I felt like I was trying to coax a big locomotive to get started somewhere, like you see in a train station, the old steam engine is coming out the side and the wheels spinning and getting going and slowly creeping out. But as soon as you got about 5 to 10 feet off the ground, it was great because the sound went away, the recirculation went away, and your thrust picked up. And it was quite a nice feeling. Every time I'd fly, as I come up through this sort of awkward liftoff thing to get into flight mode where I was above that, and then I had some power to climb out and fly away. So in that mode, it was when you're once up and away, it was sort of like a helicopter, because when you tipped it, it would translate and then pitched it over and go forward and back pretty responsively. And so it wasn't too much different than what I'd done before. But when you went into the lunar simulation, it was a different world. Like Neil had mentioned there, a lot of anticipation required, large angles required. And I think that encouraged the pilot not to sit and generate high rates going either direction, translation or fore and aft, because he knew it was going to take a while to get them stopped. So you try to keep everything within reason flying, and it still took the large angles and some time delay. Sort of took some anticipation, I guess is what you'd say, more anticipation than flying in that 1G or the Earth environment. On the landing and the control, like I said, with the lift rockets and everything, that was very smooth. That was nice control and for your touchdown and going through it. It was quick. You didn't have a lot of time. I talked about the switchology in a matter of a fraction of a second. That was important. We couldn't put all the switches, critical switches, on the stick. We put a lot of them on there, but we had some on the side panel. And the time that I had where the thing was out of balance and I was losing control of it, I went very quickly. I knew where the switch was and I moved it. I don't know what the timing was. But when both the other attitude system came in, then I over-controlled. It took me back the other way, and they call that a pilot-induced oscillation. So then I stopped that, and so what you do is you bring it back to where you have it stabilized and landed. So that, but anyway, it was a challenge to fly. I think the more you flew, the more comfortable you became in it as a different vehicle. But it was different. That weighing feature they mentioned when you went into the lunar simulation and you brought your rocket lift stick up, you brought those two 500-pound rockets online firing. That was a tedious thing for the pilot to do it exactly to get a perfect wing. And sometimes I didn't know if it was displacement or rate or displacement or what, because sometimes you'd get it to be perfect. I'd lift up that and I look up my jet engine RPM and I'd see that drop about 2.5%, and I think I'm in business. That's just about what I like, and I'd be going into lunar sim. And if it didn't work that way and that RPM dropped down further, I'd come out of it because I knew I didn't have enough lift rocket to complete the test mission and land it. But it kept you on your toes. It's a demanding machine. The Weber seat I mentioned before, it was super. And, when we did the early flights, Walker and I and then Jack Kluver, it was just like a company doing the experimental flights on a new machine. It had never flown before. We assembled it out here. We had to go through and prove all the auto throttle devices, the drag cancellation, the various control powers and things like that. And when it went down to Houston, they were operating in a little more pressure, I think, a little higher winds and things like that, and they lost them. Some were mechanical and some were just wind shear and things. And that always bothered me, but I sure felt good about the Weber seat. And the fact that we had it, and at one time there was a plan where we had 8 of these lift rockets, which would give you a max of 4,000 pounds of thrust. And the idea was if the jet engine quit, we were going to time it to where we used those rockets to get us back on the ground. But I never believed my timing was ever going to be that good. And when the decision came up to pull those off and rely on the ejection seat, if the jet engine failed, I was real happy, and I think Walker was too. I think it was a smart decision.
Well, you had to guess on what the free fall was. You did before you brought him on, and then you may be wrong. And I was glad that Kluver and I convinced Houston to take him off,
yeah,
so that astronauts wouldn't be using them down,
yeah,
there.
And I think it worked out.
Yeah. Yeah. One thing about Joe's getting his Navy training in the helicopter, Jack Kluver told me that before Joe ever started flying the LLRV in the early days, he took him out in a chopper over the lake bed, and Joe had never flown a helicopter. So he gave him the controls, and And he struggled a bit, and this was on a Friday. And so Jack comes in and asks Joe Venzel, the boss, where Joe was on Monday. And it turns out he's already down at Pensacola in helicopter training. He had pulled strings and got out of there on the weekend when he discovered how Jack
got his
attention.
Comment on that. That I don't think is unusual. Joe was such an accomplished pilot, and he had done so many programs like on the X-15 and other jets and testing. He was very confident. He hadn't been exposed too much to helicopters. I doubt very little. And I think at that time, when he went out with Kluver, he had no idea that there were a little different set of equations with flying a helicopter in a VTOL mode. I had the benefit of the background at Langley, so it wasn't a problem. But what really impressed me was the way Joe came along. He really was obvious to me he was a super pilot because he adapted to that very quickly. We flew together in a little Bell helicopter for support and proficiency. When the lunar lander wasn't flying, we'd use the Bell to fly around and do what we could proficiency-wise. And Joe was excellent. And we would challenge each other. We'd fly, if we were flying somewhere, he'd take one leg, I'd take the next. And so when you're flying with a chief pilot and you bring in a helicopter to land, you make damn sure you make a real smooth landing, which I do. So one day we're coming back from Fox to Edwards, and Joe was flying the leg, and we made an approach out here. Joe made his approach and everything, and he really made a nice approach, a very smooth landing. And if you knew Joe Walker, the first thing he'd do would be turn around and look over at me like, what did you think of that? Before he could say a word, I said, Joe, that was nice. I see you've been studying my technique. And his jaw dropped about that far. But he was a super guy. And that was a privilege to me to work with him. I said that I picked the lunar lander third. Well, I did because I was an old Navy fighter pilot background. You want to go faster and faster. But I was really happy that I was assigned to that program with him because it was a challenge. He was a true professional, and I learned a lot working with him. And it was quite a joy. Later on, we went deer hunting together, and we'd stop and have a cool beer after a hot day of work in the desert and everything, and he was a super guy.
One of the major challenges of the program was the fact that we were ahead of the power curve. We had to do things before they were defined. So we'd take the best guess, simulate, and progress with the attitude that we'll adjust as we have to, as things become clearer. That was most demonstrated in the control system. We did simulations both here. The program had done some simulations at North American in Columbus, and Gurman was doing simulation on Long Island. And control powers were in a particular ballpark. The VTOL people from Langley and Ames both were horrified. They said, you don't have enough control power. You're off by a factor of 10. You've got to reconsider this. And we checked the simulation. Everything seemed reasonable. There was a difference in the X-14 and in some of the vehicles that Langley was flying. They were using proportional control. You'd get control as you move the stick. You'd get increasingly more thrust. We were using on-off control, so you got the initial acceleration immediately, and you knew the system was working, and it gave you the acceleration, and that made all the difference in the world. And that's just really phenomenal. That it was an eye-opener to them, and in fact, on the X-14, they changed to bang-bang type control instead of proportional control because it gave them so much more control power. The LLRV was a variable stability airplane. We could do anything with that control system that we wanted to do. And we essentially established for the LEM program that rate control was what you really wanted to have. Attitude control, you could make that thing do exactly what you wanted. But from the pilot standpoint, the comfort was with the rate control, and that's what they ultimately used. The same thing with instrumentation. We were given plans for what the displays, tape displays, for major cockpit displays in the limb to be. And in our shops here, we built tapes to duplicate that. They weren't the exact hardware, but they did what was to be done.
We scaled them up so they'd fit the longer eye right. distance, too.
So we were always ahead of the curve. We were the pioneering for them and answering questions that they need to have answered way ahead of the time when they needed it. So the program was beneficial in myriads of ways.
Well, unquestionable pioneering in VTOL reaction control.
Yeah.
Yeah. One thing on the ejection seat, if I may put in, that was designed for the seat man CG to be offset from the center of thrust about 2.5 inches. And the theory was that in a VTOL, you sweep the 45-degree angle from whatever attitude you are, and so analytically you have the very best chance of survival. And so the residual momentum after ejection would normally result in a 2.5 tumble forward because of that residual offset. But that's why they measured it so accurately. And we tried to control the dry CG measurement on our weight and balance fixture to 1/10 of an inch. And then we tried to get it within 1/4 of an inch for takeoff CG control, and flight management for wet CG in flight was 1/2 inch sphere, trying to get, and we had to overcome that some of that time with the roll switch on the peroxide tanks.
And we weighed the pilots regularly to make sure that weight was maintaining within those same kind of boundaries.
Oh, we put even cans on the legs and would measure lead shot to accomplish the weight
the balance.
And balance for the different pilots. Originally, the idea was to move the payload back and forth on the back rack, and it was too much trouble. So we just put some cans on there and put a lid on it, and we'd measure the lead shot in, and off we'd go.
We have one more question from the floor.
Would each of you please explain what it meant personally and professionally to you to be a part, to have pioneered to work for the moon landings?
He said, what did it mean to you to be part of this?
Oh. During the program, like a lot of test programs you go on, first we really weren't even sure that the machine was going to work, it was going to provide the data, it was going to be as successful as it was. And of course we were pleased that it was, but I really didn't get too much of a feedback or a feeling until I was up in Bishop on vacation and we're watching Neil land on the moon at night on a black and white TV where you could hardly make it out. And I know I wasn't sweating it as much as he was, but I was sweating it. And when he landed safely, I thought, oh, that's so wonderful. So many things had to be right, and so many things had to happen correctly. So then it meant a lot more to me then, I think, down the road. And then when Neil and some of the other astronauts came back and they supported the program when some of the management wanted to cancel it after they lost a couple down there because they thought it was more dangerous for the astronauts to fly it and go to the moon. But that made me feel good that the work we had done really applied to it, and it was very worthwhile.
I was a 30-year-old youngster when we started this program, and being named chief engineer on a critical program for the country, not just for the center, but for the country, was an awesome responsibility. And I have to say, I grew into the job. I was fortunate to have Don Bellman to calm me down at times because I'd get too exuberant with things. But it was just a wonderful opportunity. And as I mentioned earlier, when we were sent to South Base with the operation, I was the czar for the operation. I got to call what we did and made sure that we had everything that we needed. And it was, as I say, it was an awesome responsibility, and it was wonderful opportunity to be able to do that. It's a dream job.
One item. Who made the first liftoff on the LLRV?
Ray White.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That's a good story.
We didn't have the jet engine installed, and we wanted to test the rocket system, and so we didn't have our hard concrete connects down there to tie it down with, so we just tied some big concrete blocks on it and figured out we had plenty. So he comes on with the all eight 500-pound rockets, and I don't know who made the wrong calculation. I'll take the blame for it, but anyway, he lifted off. not very far, you know, a few inches, but we got a kick out.
That, huh?
Okay, so that's when the first flight isn't exactly the first flight.
There you go.
My recollection or my satisfaction with the role that I played, I feel really culminated when Neil asked me to feed him some data on that video you just saw. In July of 2007, he was starting to write it. So I gave him some pictures and answered some technical questions. And then Lloyd Walsh went over and I saw him right after he gave that speech and gave him a big hug. But then that followed. I'd proposed a lunar landing conference in Tempe in 2008. And that's when the Dryden team showed up at that conference and resulted in a trade study that Houston authorized, paid for, I think. I participated in that, and it didn't culminate, but near the end was a high point where we got Neil, Gene Cernan, Harrison Jack Schmidt, and John Young. And we met down in Houston and spent a whole day telling what I call the young'uns how we did the training in the early 60s. But in a lot of work before that and during that time and even after, Dave Scott and Gene Cernan and Neil all extremely favorable to supporting a gimbal jet for the future training. And that really made me feel good here, and that was not that many years ago, really, that we did all that, because John Kelly led the team here on looking at, I think we had five different platforms that would be considered, and during that time at Houston, Joe Tanner, who had trained half the shuttle pilots in the STA and spent a lot of time out here, I think you know Joe well, I met him during this time, and he now teaches up at University of Colorado, where I live. But he had trained half those shuttles, but he had made five spacewalks as well and done a Hubble repair mission. But he and I still have a big argument going about two-place cockpit for a future LLTV or a single cockpit. And I'll tell you, all the Apollo astronauts, they just want one because they feel like that they gotta know they can do it by themselves. And they can eject here and survive, as Gene Cernan says, and live to go on another training flight, but they can't do that on the moon. And it really gives them that self-confidence if they can do it well here on the Earth.
And they only want to be responsible for one soul.
Yes.
That's right. That's true. Yeah, there's a lot of issues, and I'm proposing that Joe Tanner and I have a debate in Boulder in front of the CU aerospace engineering people and invite some of these guys from Apollo to come and help me defend their position.
Well, of all the astronauts who flew to the moon and used the LLRV TV, I only know one that objected to having that. All the rest of them were unanimous that was absolutely essential.
Well, and I think they all, during the time that they were taking it, and I think the one exception you may be talking about is in later years, yep. I hate to say it, but dementia set in.
So we have a question hanging for Dave Stoddard. Same question everybody else has been responding to about what this meant to you professionally and personally.
What did it mean to me?
Right.
And being part of the program.
I don't know. I'll tell you, this LLRV and this program are one of the most interesting and programs that I've ever been on. I think it tops the list, maybe X-15 and the fly-by-wire. But, you know, working on this program, you've seen the pictures of it flying, but anybody that was involved with it, servicing it and such, you know, other programs, why the airplane takes off, you see it take off, you see it land, they go out and do their things. But this airplane, you sit right there with the pilot. and as he went through his maneuvers, you were kind of sitting there right with him. I think that's what made it so interesting, that you were involved with it every minute. It only lasted a few seconds, but you were right there. So I think that was one reason I think it was the most interesting program that I ever been on.
Thanks.
After our last flight, Paul Bickel took me aside, and he said, "You're either the luckiest guy in the world or the smartest guy in the world." And I opted for being lucky.
One final question to wrap up the afternoon's panel, and I'll direct this to Gene. The LLRV was a national, it was part of a national effort. It was focused on Apollo. It was focused on moon landing. So everything, so all of the energy was being directed away from the center to something bigger. But what impact do you think the LLRV program had on this research center?
It gave us stature. It put us into the ball game. The space people kind of looked down their nose at us, particularly when we started out in it all. They were the experts. Who are you upstarts? And I think we earned our spurs.
Fly-by-wire started.
Yeah, that's right. This was truly the first fly-by-wire airplane that had no mechanical backup in anything. So it had to work. Mm-hmm. And that's why Bickel was so questionable, that we could do this without a failure along the way. And he made that comment to me. He said, this fly-by-wire stuff, he was an old stick-and-rudder guy. And this all-electronic stuff just wasn't his cup of tea.
The F-8 with the Apollo computer wouldn't have happened without the LLRV.
That's probably right. So it really gave us stature. It put us in the ballgame.
Thank you. I think this is a good place to wrap up the afternoon. We have LLRV number 2 on display. The building next to the room next to 4801 is open, and so we can go from here over there to take a look. I'd like you to join me in thanking our panel. So that concludes the formal presentation. Mm-hmm.